Mr. Peterson, I have to turn this off.
Plug this in.
Okay, let's push this and put this over here.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
We're so happy to be here this morning to share with you. Just a quick question. How many of you have children? I mean, they're young, old. My age, your age, how many of you have children? Just raise your hand if you can. Okay. Amen. And most of you know that raising children is a job. Right? Right?
Amen.
It is. Do you believe it's a job? I do. However, amen, whatever you do, knowing that it's a job, may the work that you've done, whatever you've done, is going to speak for you. So the song that I'm going to minister to you this morning is, may the works I've done speak for me. May the works I've done speak for me. Speak for me.
Thank you.
About
minister of Jesus, to come here on this planet and to be born and to die. I mean, it happened. We hear that to some degree, and we teach it, and it goes off the tongue so easy. He came to the cross. It's almost like a cliche. Jesus Christ came in the world. He came to the cross, and he died for our sins, and he grew. And you know, that's the end of the story. But in actuality, his resurrection was the beginning of something. And it was the beginning of something that this world needed, but yet sometimes we hear very little of. It is okay for people to teach prosperity and blessing and things of this nature. That's fine to teach those things, but we can never lose sight of the simple truth of the gospel or the good news that the Bible talks about. And not only did the Bible talk about this, but there are certain historians. There were Babylonian historians, Roman historians, that talked about the death of Jesus Christ and that Jesus had died on the cross and the proclamations that were made. Now, it is important for people, even Christians, to realize that when Jesus Christ came into this world, it was for God's purpose, and his purpose was to display the love of God toward us. The problem or issue that we have with the term love, it is so misunderstood. People many times think love means that you do something to make me pleasurable. If it makes me pleasurable, then it is love. If it does not hurt me, then it is love. So our concept of love has diminished to doing things that particularly are in my favor. It makes me feel good. It makes me feel complete. It makes me. That's the issue. When God, the Bible says, God commended in Romans chapter 5, and that word commended actually means demonstrated. God commended or demonstrated his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. There are predominantly, what I see in society, two gospels. There's the gospel of America, or what I call the gospel of America, or the United States, and there's the gospel of Jesus Christ. The gospel of America teaches this. If you don't do anything wrong or do anything purposely to hurt anyone, if you don't lie, if you don't steal, if you don't cheat, if you don't sleep around, if you don't murder, if you don't do these things, if you don't go around deliberately hurting someone's feelings, attacking people, then you're a good person. And if you're a good person, then that kind of makes you a candidate for sainthood. I mean, you really haven't done anything to hurt anybody. So as long as we don't do anything or say anything to hurt anyone, predominantly you're thought of as a good person. But the biblical definition of good actually only amounts to one person, and that's God. The Bible says that there is none righteous, no, not one. There's none that understand. There's none that seeks after God. Since we have all gone out of the way, we have all become unprofitable. There is none that does good, no, not one. So the American teaching or American gospel says that as long as I do or don't do something that's hurtful or offensive to someone, then I'm okay. I'm a good person. But the word of God or the Bible or the gospel of Christ says that everybody, and concludes the whole world, is under sin. Everybody. According to the Bible, the word of God, there is not a good person on this planet. And I can tell you right now, if somebody push your buttons,
the wrong way, what's in you eventually is going to come out. Apart from God, there is no true concept of one being good. So when Christians go around and tell people that they're sinners, then sometimes that's offensive to people. Because we think, predominantly in our culture, that we're good people. See, sin seems to connotate something that is deplorable, something that is diabolical, something that is evil. And so when we tell a person, when we say the Bible says that a person is a sinner, the people get hostile. When we talk about people's lifestyles, they get hostile. When we talk about people, what they think, how they say, and how they act, and we use the term unholy, ungodly, then this becomes an issue with many people in our culture. Now, I can't talk about adequately other places or other countries because I live in the United States. So I can only tell you maybe what I've read or what I've seen on TV or video. But I live here in the United States, so I know how it is. I know how it is here. I know how our culture and what our culture predominantly thinks. So what I'm going to do, again, in a series of teaching, we need to understand something about the gospel. We need to understand something about the good news of Jesus. In the Bible, we hear sometimes one of the scriptures that we hear the most, John 3:16. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And then the next verse says, for God said, not sent into the world to condemn the world, but judge the world. And that's another word in our culture. That's for God. Judge. Say somebody did something wrong. Oh, you're judging. You're judging. How do you say I have this kind of lifestyle? Oh, you're judging me. No. Who are you to judge? Who are you to judge? But, you know, people have to understand. Look, I want to re-explain some things that I've said before. The New Testament in the Bible, well, the Bible itself was predominantly written in three predominant languages. Hebrew, Aramaic, well, I'll say four. There's a little bit of Syriac. And the New Testament was written in what's called Koine Greek. Koine Greek basically was a common everyday language that people could understand. So there are certain words that were written in the Bible that mean certain things. There are certain phrases that meant certain things, and in our culture sometimes we don't understand certain phrases or things that were said. So now when the Bible used the term judging, and sometimes people say that, they say that to Christians. So we don't want to say anything that's considered derogatory to society in general because we all look at as one who's judging. But yet, interestingly enough, you know, people, and it's interesting that this is the time that people become biblical scholars. All of a sudden now, people can quote the Bible. They can quote things that are written in the Bible. Well, you know, the Bible says, judge not that we not judge. But they would have to understand why that was written. And Jesus was the first one who actually makes that statement. Paul reiterates it in Romans chapter 2, but you have to understand why he said it. And the reason why, during Jesus' time, the religious leaders, they were condemning people for not following the law, what they call the law of Moses. And then there was something also called the tradition of the elders. And these were things that were added to the commandments. And the commandments basically were in what they call people became engrossed in this so much that they misunderstood the way of righteousness. Now, here in the Bible, in the Word of God, what God does is He explains to us the proper understanding of what He is saying. In Romans chapter 1, verse 16, the Apostle Paul says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and he says, and also to the Greek." Now, it really meant the Gentile. And he says, "For in what? In the gospel of Jesus Christ, a righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith." So, involving in the gospel is the concept of faith. But even faith itself does not necessarily mean that you have no reason whatsoever. Because even in the book of Isaiah, the first chapter, when God talks to the nation of Israel, he said, "Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool." Then he goes on to make a statement. He said, "If you be willing and obedient, you'll eat the good of the land." He said, "But if you refuse and you rebel, you'll be devoured by the sword." And this is the God that we said is a loving God. So there was a concept of love we don't understand. We hear, or sometimes I've heard the word agape. Some people say agape. Agapeo, Greek word, love. And really what it means, agapeo really means it is an act of the will. It is an act of a will that you will do what is best for an individual. That's really what love is. It is doing what is best. Now, when I was growing up in Philadelphia, my parents, what they thought was best for me, and what they did that was best for me, was quite often painful. And I mean physically painful. Because they were still, well, some people say spanking, you say beating, whichever way you want to say, use the term corporal punishment. And I got a lot of corporal punishment. A lot of it. Because I was always doing things to get myself into some kind of trouble. All the time. Constantly. And so, we don't see that concept of love that sometimes love causes pain. It doesn't always make you feel good, but whatever happens will be for your good. That's what we misunderstand. The Bible even says sometimes whom the Lord loves, he chastens, and he scourges every one of his sons. So what I want to end with today, for them, is the gospel of Jesus Christ is a demonstration of the love of God. Because in our culture in the United States, I mean, we live in a country that is what's called imperialistic. And imperialistic means that whatever you say, goes. So that's why a lot of times Americans go into different countries. And we figure because we're Americans, we can do pretty much what we want. And then we end up getting in trouble, and then going to the State Department or going to somebody and trying to get fired. So we live in an imperialistic, capitalistic society that itself, at its heart, I don't think a lot of people have even read the Constitution or fully understand. I understand the preamble to the Constitution. You know, one of the phrases that we hold these truths up evident that all men are created people and are endued by their creator of certain inalienable rights. These rights being liberty, the law of liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. All these things we heard. But creator is such a generic term. When you say creator, who? Who is that creator? So our Constitution is vague. It never actually tells you who the creator is. Now, in many of our founding fathers' writings, they use America stands for, then you look at the foundation of what it stands. If it stands on the Bible, then everything it does will be produced from the Bible. But if the Bible is not the foundation of this country, then what's produced from it will not coincide with the Bible. And it is evident, it stands to reason, if you see how a culture is being raised, if you see how a society, how it generates its laws, if you look at our laws, if you look at how our businesses operate, how our justice system operates, all of these things, when they begin to extract and remove God from what their processes and purposes are, when they remove God from it, then you see what actually stands for. And it's not God. It is not the word of God. People might hear things like this, but that's what I like about the gospel. Because the gospel will show you who God is, what his purpose for sending Jesus Christ is, and it'll also show you who you are. So today, this day, this year, 2016, you want to know what it means?